Hello guys, happy Thursday. I hope you're enjoying your Thursday today. It's almost Friday soon, yay! Today I thought I would carry on reading my Dante's Inferno, as I have been reading it recently and it's my book series that I'm currently reading. I'm currently reading Dante's Inferno and The Red Necklace is part of my book series. If anyone has any requests for any like other books they want me to read other than these, then please let me know in the comments down below and I'll try and read that book. Or if it's a short story you want me to read, then let me know. We are up to, recently we just read Inferno Canto 3, which is the third canto, and now we are on to Inferno Canto 4. So we are getting through this book very slowly as it goes along. If you are enjoying this book so far, please let me know, because this was requested by Jeff Music Man, one of my special friends, and he asked me to read this. So I'm going to carry on reading it today. So let us start, shall we? A heavy clap of thunder resounded through the valley and startled me from a deep, deep sleep, like a person who is fearfully shaken awake. I looked around with barely rested eyes and stood up and surveyed my surroundings. Trying hard to recognise where I was, I slowly realised that I was standing on the ledge of the valley of great pain and suffering, which collects the sounds of the endless laments. It was obscure, hazy and limitless, but when I attempted to see the bottom, I was not able to make out the shape of anything. "We will descend now into the blind world," Virgil said with uncertainty. "I will go first, and you will follow me." And then I saw the hesitation in his face. I said, "How can I come if you are afraid? Who will be my comfort and settle my fears if not you?" And he said to me, "The anguish of the people who are down here fills my mind with pity, which you have wrongly seen as fear. We must get started now, for we have a long way to go." Then we went in, and this made me enter as well. We entered the first circle that surrounds the abyss. Am I saying this right? Abyss? Because I said abyss before, so it's the abyss. Because Jeff commented on that, I said abyss. Or whatever I said before, but it's abyss, yeah. Down there, using only my ears to guide me, were not limitations, but only sighs that filled the endless and everlasting air. And there arose from sorrow and not from torment. These arose from sorrow and not from torment. Sorry guys, fucking hell, I have bloody read. From the massive crowds that we encountered, of men and of women and even children and infants, then to me the Master said, "You have not asked who these spirits are, which you now see, but I will tell you before we go any further. These are the ones who have not sinned, and if they have merit, it was not enough, because they were not happy, they were not baptized, which is the gateway to heaven in the faith that you follow. And those that were born before Christ, and therefore did not know how to worship God. It is among these that I too reside. I am from here. It is this defect, and not from any other guilt, that we are lost, and our punishment is that we live on the desire alone, but without hope." Grief seized my heart when I heard this, because I knew that some great and worthy people were also suspended in that limbo. "Tell me, Master, please tell me," began wanting to know for certain that faithful long can overcome such an error. Has there been ever been anyone by his own merit, by any another's, who is blessed and allowed to leave? And he who understood my hidden question replied, I had not been here very long when I saw Christ himself come down, wearing the signs of heaven as his crown. First he drew forth the ghost of Adam, and that of his son Abel, and of Noah, of Moses, the lawgiver, and the obedient. Patriarch Abraham and King David, Israel with his father and his children, and Rachel for whose sake he did so much, and many others as well, and he blessed them. But I will also tell you that before these, no human spirits were ever spared. He stopped moving forward as he spoke, but the crowd continued passing onward like a forest not of trees, but of thickly crowded ghosts. We had not gone very far, and were still on the side of the summit, when I saw a fire that cast a bright light in the darkness. We were still a little distant from it, but not so far that I could not make out some of the honourable people who were in that place. You who know so many from every art and science, who are those which appear to have such great honour that they stand apart from all the others. And he said to me, the honourable names that you have spoken so highly of in your life wins them grace in heaven, so favours them here. In the meantime, a voice was heard coming towards us, all honour to the preeminent poet. His ghost that was departed has returned again. So the voice had ceased and was quiet. Four mighty ghosts approached us, their faces showing neither happiness nor sorrow. Then my gracious master said to me, he with that sword in his hand, who comes before the other three, is there a leader? That one is Homer, the sovereign poet. Homer, it just reminds me of Simpsons when I hear that name, so funny. He who comes next to Horace, the satirist. The third is Ovid, and the last is Lucan, because each of these shares the same honour with me that you heard proclaimed. They also honour me as I honour each of them, and I watched as they gathered together, leaning toward their Lord. His voice of the others soars like an eagle. After they had spoken among themselves, they turned to me with signs of greetings, and seeing this, my master smiled. They granted me more than honour, much more. In that they made me one of their own group, so that I was a sixth, and such great minds, amid such great minds. Then we continued walking to the light, saying things that were best left unsaid, and yet saying them all the same. We came to the foot of a noble castle, seven times summoned of high walls, and all encompassed of a flowing stream. We passed over the water as though it were firm ground, then passed through seven doors of these sages. Finally we came into a fresh green meadow. People were there whose eyes were solemn and grave. They had great authority in their bearing. They seldom spoke, and when they did, it was with gentle voices. And we went through a wall into a lofty and luminous opening, so everyone around us was suddenly visible. There, opposite, upon the green meadow, were pointed out to me the mighty spirits, whom I feel exalted to have seen. I saw a lecturer with many companions, and with her were Hector and, I don't know how you say that name, and Irene and Aeneas, I don't know how you say it. It's spelled AENEAS. So if anyone can pronounce that name, please let me know in the comments down below because I can't pronounce it. I know Jeff probably will know what, how to say it. Caesar in full armor with his large dark eyes. I saw Camilla and Pethysilea. Pethysilea, I don't know how you say that. You know, these are long names. On the other side, and saw King Lantus, who sat with Lafiana, his daughter. I saw Brutus, who drove Tanquin forth, Lucretia, Julian, Marcia, and Cornelia, and saw standing alone, apart from the others, the Sladin. When I lifted up my eyes a little, I saw the great master, Astoli, sitting with his philosophical family. Everyone gazed upon him, and all do him honour. With him I saw both Socrates and Plato, who stood nearer to him than the others. Democritus, who said the world was chance. Diogenes and Anaxagoras and Thales, oh fucking hell, he's a long name. Zeno, Emperor Thocles, and Heraclitus. I saw the collector Deiocides and Ophirius to the end, Linus and Moral Cenicia, Euclid, Gamertius, and Ptolemy, Galen, Hippocrates, and I can't say half of these fucking names, if I pronounce them wrong, guys. And Alvincia, Averius, who made the great complimentary. I don't know how to say half of these names, they're fucking hard to say. I cannot fully describe all of them because there were so many that even listing them all. I am certain to miss a few. Our group of six divides, and we again become two. My guide leads me away from the others, out from the quiet, and to a place where the air seems to tremble, and we again into a place where there is no light. And there you go, guys. That's the end of Inferno Canto 4, which is the end of Inferno Canto 4. So now we are on to the next canto, which is Inferno Canto 5. This is getting to be a very interesting book as you go along, because I've been told what it's exactly about. I read up on it and I know what exactly it's about because Jeff has mentioned to me a bit about it, and some of it can be related to Devil May Cry and in some ways and the game, and the fact that I think in one of the Devil May Cries I think Virgil is in one of them. I don't know which one it is, but Virgil's in one of them. That's why there's a bit of a guy called Virgil in it, because he's in that as well. One Devil May Cry. But anyway, guys, I hope you enjoyed me reading this again, and hopefully I will read the next canto in the next few days, or whenever I can do the video next of the next canto. So I hope you all have a wonderful Thursday today, guys, and you enjoyed this story, if you're enjoying this story so far, little book, you know, Devil's in Dante's Inferno, let me know in the comments down below and give this video a thumbs up. If you are new to my channel, don't forget to subscribe. In the meantime, guys, have a fantastic day, and I will see you all guys later. Goodbye.